Thank you, Marika. Good morning, everyone. Glad you're here to worship with us on this Sunday morning, the 2nd of August. I'm glad you're all here. Let me ask if anybody has any announcements about activity going on either in the church or a community that you'd like us to be aware of this morning. Yeah. Okay. It is. Admire the handiwork. So thank you. Thank you to you and Dean for doing the cleaning work and painting. And Marla. Okay. Right. And there may be a couple of other opportunities where you can help contribute this fall. We watch for more information as we live day by day trying to figure out how to navigate through these times that we find ourselves in. Okay. Yeah. Very good. Anything else? An original plan scheduled a number of months ago, I was going to be gone this weekend, which is why we're doing communion next Sunday on the 9th of August, because I wasn't going to be here today, but plans changed, like I'm sure a lot of you have had plans change in the last few months, and so I'm here today. Bless you for that. So, and that explains why communion is next week, because that was when we had it scheduled. Someone singing, Lord, Kumbaya. Someone singing, Lord, Kumbaya. Someone singing, Lord, Kumbaya. Kumbaya. Someone's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. Someone's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. It's praying, Lord, Kumbaya. That was every bit as good as the video. Outstanding. So sort of in keeping with that theme, I invite us to join together as we offer our prayer for meeting with God together. And it's a response prayer, so you get to do the people part. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we praise you for who you are and what you have done. You are our healer. You are our righteousness. You are our provider. You are the God who is with us. You are the Lord of hosts. You are the God of peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we're going to, hopefully, if everything goes well, hear a song that reminds us of who we are gathered in his presence. The goodness of God and what God has done for us and continues to do for us. And the miracle that the creator of the universe wants to meet with us. So hopefully we'll get to celebrate that this morning. God, thank you. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your willingness to be with us, even in the trying moments of life, when our plans become your plans. We are mindful, Lord, of how grateful we are for the signs of new life and for the birth of young folks. And we just pray, Lord, that you would keep everybody healthy. Even as we're reminded that we do have a future and a hope to look forward to. We're also mindful, Lord, of people who have lost loved ones this past week. So we remember Donna and Bob's family as they mourn their family members passing. And we're mindful, too, Lord, of all the folks that are dealing with different kinds of issues. Some that are afraid to leave their houses and others that have no fear. Help us to always remember, gracious Lord, that you are ever present and that we can turn to you any time of the day or night and know that you are there to comfort us and to guide us and lead us. So hear us as we offer to you our lives and our prayers today. Asking all in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray with words like these. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Oh, good, it's going to work.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah.
you, but I need that reminder from time to time that no matter what it is I'm facing, God is the constant in a changing world, and I can always remember that God has been so, so good. And it's what gives me the ability to deal with today and to look forward in hope to tomorrow. We've done our prayer time, so in response to our prayer, as we are adjusting our order, I wanted to share this video with you today by an old friend for First Presbyterian Church in Conrad. This is written and sung by Michael Card, who's been with us on several occasions in the past years. And as you may know, Michael specializes in writing songs that directly relate to Scripture. So let me share with you 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. These are words you may have heard before. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, that's what we get to do. Then, God says, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. That's God's part of the relationship. So here's a song that takes that scripture to heart. song that might be more appropriate for not only our community, but our country, and in fact, the world, than that one today. So I would encourage you to take the words of that song to heart. Our scripture lesson for this morning comes from the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. So let me invite us to listen as we hear God's word this morning. Paul writes, God save you through faith as an act of kindness. You had nothing to do with it. Being saved is a gift from God. It's not the result of anything you've done, so no one can brag about it. God has made us what we are. He has created us in Christ Jesus to live lives filled with good works that He has prepared for us to do. So let's now ask the Spirit to take those words and speak the truth of them into our lives for living in these days. Let us pray. Lord, we ask that you would not only be present, but make your presence known to us through these next few moments as your word comes to us through your Spirit. Help us to treasure these words, to hide them deep in our hearts, that we might more faithfully live for Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Well, this isn't a complicated passage, really. The hard part is not understanding what it says. The hard part is living it in our daily lives. And unfortunately for you and me, that means that we have some responsibility here. So let's start with responsibilities, and let's make sure that we're clear about what God's responsibility is and what our responsibility is in this relationship that we have with God through Jesus Christ. And we hear very clearly right off the bat, Paul reminding the church that God is the one who saves. We don't. We get so obsessed with trying to do God's job of figuring out who's going to heaven and who's not. And that's not our job. Thank goodness it's not our job. I would have a hard time trying to figure out if I've done enough to get into heaven, let alone anybody else. God has that responsibility. And of course, we know that it's God's job only because it took a perfect human being to be the ultimate sacrifice for our sins. And that was His Son, Jesus Christ. Have you ever wondered why God bothered? When you look at the Old Testament history and you remember what the Jews' pattern, or what we used to call the sin cycle, that kept repeating itself over and over and over again in the Old Testament. They would be right with God, and then they would start wandering away and following other gods and breaking the covenant that they had with God. And God's hand of judgment would fall to call them back. And eventually they would come back, and God would forgive their sins and reestablish the covenant with them once again. And then they would fall away again, and just going through the cycle over and over and over again. And you wonder after a while whether God would finally say, all right, enough. But God's mercy and God's grace never stop. Just like we looked at that opening song, Christ in Me. He's running after us all the time with His arms outstretched, saying, I love you. I desperately want to forgive you and be in relationship with you. God gives us a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance. He doesn't even count. We can see it in the scriptures, but we've experienced it ourselves. That we are made right with God, not because of what we've done, but because what God has done for us. And there's nothing we can do to earn God's kindness. Now, does that mean we just get our forgiveness card played and then we go out and do life again exactly like we did before? Hopefully not. But God is always ready to forgive. That's who He is. And we should not abuse that kindness that God continues to show us day by day. So our role is to be thankful for God's kindness that knows no boundaries, no end. It just keeps happening over and over and over again. God continues to run after us and saying, I love you. And ours is say, thank you, don't stop. Let me demonstrate how thankful I am by the conduct of my life. And so when we understand that God's forgiveness is a gift, along with the gift of faith, to believe in what Jesus did and said was true, then our responsibility is to receive those gifts with a sense of graciousness and thank you. According to Paul, our witness is found in how we live out our lives, and he says, with humility. How we show our gratitude is how we let other people know that God is not only present, but that Jesus was who he said he was, and that the Spirit lives in each one of us as believers. God's love is the only reason that we have a relationship with God. And so what I've said here is that we need to monitor the pronoun factor. If we're talking about faith in terms of I did this and I did that, we've got the wrong pronoun. Our faith is based on what God has done and our receiving that with gratitude and humility. I haven't deserved to give these gifts. Now, how about you, but in our society, we have, in many senses, lost the ability to receive gifts graciously. Have you ever run across that situation where somebody gives you a gift, and what's the first thing you think about? Well, what am I going to give that person back? That has to be at least the same value. Well, when it comes to our relationship with God, we have nothing to give. Right? We have nothing that compares with God's infinite love for us and the costliness of demonstrating that love with Jesus Christ and the presence and power of the Holy Spirit as a gift that now lives in us as believers. I don't know about you, but when you think about that, that's what leads us to humility. It's what causes me to say, I can't do anything to earn that. But God has given it to me graciously. Can I just say, thank you, God, without any other strings attached? So, if I can't do anything to earn God's forgiveness, then what is my responsibility? What am I to do? I am to take my life and live God's agenda rather than mine. One of the ways I used to talk about this is always say, you know,
isn't God lucky to have me on his team? Yeah, I'm just such an awfully good person, and I can do so many different things for God. Isn't God lucky? It's funny because it sounds that arrogant. No. It isn't about what I can do for God. That's the wrong pronoun. It's what he has done for me. And my life is a forever thank you for what he's done for me. And so, as some of you know, my definition of life is one big adjustment of my agenda to God's agenda. God's agenda is unchanging. It never changes. My agenda changes constantly because I think I know what I want to do for God. And then I have to constantly be reminded, no, I'm not in control. What God wants to do through me is way more important than what I want to do for God. And so I need to remind myself that God has a plan for my life. God has built me a certain way and gifted me a certain way in order that I might accomplish God's plan for my life. And my responsibility is to get me out of the way and let God's plan flow out of me into the world. Paul describes it as being other-focused. Michael Card talks about it in terms of having a mind for peace and taking care of the poor, which was Jesus' words about our responsibility. The least of these we are to take care of. And in summary then, I think that it's the difference between pursuing happiness, which we tend to want to do as human beings, and pursuing fulfillment, living into what God has planned for my life, and finding joy in being obedient to God's plan and God's agenda rather than my own. When we can do that, and we are in sympathy with how God is transforming not only us, but transforming the world and redeeming the world around us, we can be more and more aware of the presence and power of God, not only in us, but flowing through us out into the world. And we remind ourselves that the things that happen in our lives are not accidental. They're intentional. They're part of the unfolding of God's plan in the world. And they're opportunities we have been given by God to demonstrate our ability to say, thank you, God, for redeeming me. Help me be the arms and legs and feet and hands and spokesperson for God's redeeming work in the world. That's each of our responsibilities in the body of Christ. Let's pray. God, you are so good. You have been good, you are good, and you will continue to be good because that's who you are. And thank you, Lord, that you didn't just create the world and then get it started and then retreat to heaven and everything's on autopilot, but that you thought about each one of our lives before any of creation came to be. You formed and made us. You have gifted us and planned for our lives. You know us better than we know ourselves. Each one of us. And you have put us on planet Earth in this time and place for your purposes. Help us to not spend so much time thinking about what we're going to do, and instead, Lord, to focus on what you want to do through us. Let our best ability be availability for you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. We've got a concluding song that sort of summarizes this idea that rather than focusing on what I can do for God, I need to focus on how God is going to work in and through my life. So, Christ in me.
Gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can seem all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Christ live and flow through our lives out into the world.